gosh.
But the girls, they kind of used it. We, next year we'll purge ourselves of this.
I think you threw it away.
Holy Spirit prayer. I mean, what? Name of the Father, the Holy Spirit. Father, the Son. Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Father, lean in our hearts and our hearts. Come by the name of the power of the session. Something that came out of our meeting, and I'm sure that Billy will talk to you about it, will be things that we talk about. Let's dive into De Anima. Now, here's what's going to happen with this class. So there's going to be four classes in the month of September that I will miss. So, and amongst all my travels, like tomorrow, what we did is for every class that I'll miss, I have to do three classes in that week. So Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday to make up for a class that I'll miss, like next Monday, for example. And then, but even with our best efforts, because we want to give a regular environment to you guys so that you don't have too many jostles to upset your studies, we won't do morning classes anymore. That was just a very stressful thing, and it was just a horrible practice to even think about. So So instead, what we'll do is we'll have those classes, instead of, basically there's four classes that I'll miss without being able to make up in the mornings. And so those missed classes, there's four of them, so you can imagine the social doctrine classes and two Danimal classes that we'll be behind. And, we don't want that. We want you to stay right on that content level. So we're going to transform all of those into four classes. You have two additional classes in De Anima. And Father Francis Therese has agreed to teach two of them. And that's what we need to find a teacher for the other two. So that means in September, you'll be two classes ahead in the De Anima course than you will in the Social Doctrine of the Church. And then what I'll do is in the next month, when I'm here, I'll just teach two less of the De Anima and two more of the Social. Might be confusing, and you probably don't care, but I'm anxious to show you just how much your regular rhythm counts. Alright. Some of us carry scars. I don't know who in this room carries such scars. Yours truly, of course. No problem. Alright. So what I want to do with the onion, I want to attack. I told Father Francis Therese he could do the induction of the soul, so if you look at your syllabus, anyone have the syllabus? Let's take a look at class number two. I think it's Induction of the Soul, one and two. Yes, so he wants to do the Induction of the Soul. So let me give an overview of De Anima for you. De Anima is the book by Aristotle that translates as... Nice. On the soul. I'm going to give you some tips for how to read Aristotle, and I'm going to walk through a basic outline, very basic outline, but an overview of what that book entails. And the goal is to prep you for the rest of the class, so that the brother can walk in and induce the soul, three degrees of light, and your enemies. So this is going to be kind of like an introduction into the philosophy of Aristotle. Let's do that introduction. Who is this Aristotle? Aristotle is approximately, because I don't know the exact dates, 400 BC. So this is the time of the wisdom literature being written in the Bible. It's 400 years before Christ. David was 1,000 BC. So just 600 years to King David. So if King David was alive in the year 1400, that would be the equivalent of where we are today. He lived in Greece, and he was born in this and living in this philosophical milieu. So remember we said that philosophy is what in Greek? What does it mean? Love of wisdom. It was a time where you had some of the greatest minds, the greatest emergences of minds. So historians and sociologists go back and they look at ancient Greece and they're like, why did these guys think so deeply? And it wasn't just the Greeks, it was the Egyptians who were inventing mathematics and algebra and looking at all these different things. In China, you had this all same thing. It was a moment in history of humanity where you just had a tremendous amount of intellectual work. They think that the word soul, for example, that Plato uses, anima, actually has its ancient roots in India. So there were philosophers talking about soul all the way from India to bring it over. And so we've lost a lot of the wisdom of how this all happened by a library in a city called Alexandria, Egypt, that burned to the ground. That, when that library in Alexandria burned, we lost a treasure for humanity. All this wisdom and understanding of where things came from, and all kinds of books, including books by Aristotle, and most notably, the book by Aristotle that carried the title On God, was lost. You're like, no. But it's true. I would love if someone could find, you know, some information and tell me a little bit about the burning of the library. I was like, I know that had happened, and it was devastating. But, like, I'd love to know that. What's all the history behind it? Why the burning set the fire? Or the impact? In any case, when that loss, like, you have to remember that it's not just like guys were sitting on trees and coming up with ideas. They were in contact with these other ancient cultures and ancient wisdom. And that contact was, they were cutting edge for their days. Writing things like myths. So Plato, you have all the people that you basically have philosophy is divided into what we call the pre-Socratics, those who come before Socrates. Then the emergence of Socrates. And then, of course, the student of Socrates, Plato, and then the student of Plato, Aristotle. And with Aristotle, you really hit an apex. After Aristotle, you have the Stoics, and then things just kind of like diverge. But these three right here, Socrates, as Bill and Ted say, Bill and Ted that fun adventure, Socrates. Whoa! Those three there just are the champions of a thought that shaped Western civilization. Because these Greek thinkers had a perspective. Then you had the Romans, and especially the Romans' understanding of the Stoicism, which came after them. But the big contribution that Romans had, law and order. And then, of course, at the same time as you had the Romans, you have the Jews, preceding them all. The allegiance, if you want to be a fancy kind of like neo-intellectual type that like Savannah would be the first things, you'd say, it's the mixture of Athens, Rome, and Jerusalem. Pope Benedict uses that kind of thing all the time. That constitute the intellectual heritage of the West. And the reason why that's important is that what the West gave the world is pretty impressive. Democracy, the universities, hospitals, And these things have, of course, shaped the world. So much so that when you leave the West, you leave a civilization. So where are the borders of the West? I'll leave that to you. But usually you can find them by those who deny Athens. So those who deny Athens, skeptics, relativists, nihilists, kind of like people that float around all over today. There is no truth, it's possible no truth, don't even think too much, just feel, blah, blah, blah. People who leave Rome, the sense of law and order that comes from our tradition all the way back in Rome. Law can be self-defined. There was a guy who gave me a document, and I have it in my room. And it's a study that was done in 1947 of a guy who studied why the Roman Empire fell. And he lists off something like 17 things about marriage and the family. He said, Rome fell because of the family. The family is corrupted. And he lists all these facts that I never knew. Concubinage, you know, living in sin, so to speak, was widespread and accepted. Homosexuality was widespread and accepted. Pornography, all the things that we're looking at in our society today. And the guy makes a statement in this study that never in civilization has a society fallen because of the family and been restored. Once the family goes, the civilization is destroyed. That would be very, very, very compelling. Well, that would be a rejection of Rome, of the sense of law and order. And then a sense of the difference between that, of course, and Jerusalem. This is the Judeo tradition. There is a God, he is just and punishing, and he's also tender and loving. He gives commandments, and he reveals to us these following things. Christ died in Jerusalem. Those combination of three. So the reason I'm saying that is because all of our culture, including why you're wearing shorts right now, you know, why you're allowed to wear shorts, why you're allowed to wear makeup, why it's considered acceptable for women to have bare shoulders, that's all coming from a culture that's actually coming from these three things. It's so easy to find. Because these, they're in part, but these three people such an impact. Socrates has a type of writing called a dialogue. And this is where it's really funny to read that. You know, it's like, I do say, he has one, for example, called Theaetetus, which is one that I read in its entirety, 287 pages, of him asking the question, what does it mean? And then Theaetetus is like, well, surely, Socrates, to know means to sense things and feel them. And then he goes on for like 70 pages to show him that, although that is a very brilliant thing, in fact, no. And Theaetetus saying, indeed, you are brilliant, Socrates. He says, well, then what is to know? And then, boom, they go through three cycles. And at the end, Socrates is like, no, we still don't know, but the sun is going down. So let us meet another time to continue our conversation. It's fascinating. It's a great read. It's a tremendous formation of the mind. And you push it very far, but like, wow. Plato used, as his style, myths and dialogue. The Platonic myths. What would happen is Plato would be very logical, and he'd get to a certain point where there's a problem. Like one of the famous works by Plato is called the Symposium. And it's where he asks, what is love? What is the source of love? And he gets all the way, you know, to like, he's thinking it through. Love is this. No, it's like this. It must surely be this. And then when he can't explain it anymore, he bursts into a myth. I know there was this original God who loved this other God. And the two of them gave a child who stole an apple. And then souls came out of it. And it's like all this weird stuff. But he uses and resorts to myths as a way of saying truths. It's amazing. And it's very just not our way of knowing. So a lot of times he'll start like, what is soul? Plato's the first one to write a major book on it. The other ones we have little writings. Plato talked about it extensively. What is the soul? And goes to the myths. Well, in the beginning, it was this, and that's where souls come from. Basically, all the souls exist eternally, and then you're thrown into a body. And so then in different parts, there's writings of early Plato, middle Plato, late Plato, you kind of see different things. Reincarnation, Platonic, totally believes in it. If you're bad, you become a dog, and if you're good, you become this. If you're bad, you're a woman. If you're good, you're a man. And you go. So you guys were all men. You screwed around in their lives. That's why they became you. I was just horrible. And that's what Plato says. Then, Aristotle. The reason I spent all this time is that I want you to appreciate who this guy was. Aristotle took a different approach. He took what's called the approach of realism. That word is very simple to understand, and yet extremely difficult to defend. If you understand it, you will soar on the wings of eagles. You will be very intelligent. You'll be able to understand Western civilization and thought, and you will have good, happy marriages and become a perfect human being. If you try to doubt it, it's very hard to defend. And that's because what Aristotle holds is that being, I'll put it in Latin, in primo, cadi ens. It's a quote from St. Thomas Aquinas. I wrote it Greek, and I wrote Greek. In primo, cadi ens. Which means that for Aristotle, being is self-evident. Aristotle. In primo cadidens means first, in the first place, falls in being. So into the intelligence. When I see Tim, the very first thing that happens is I know that Tim is. And I know that Tim's being is not my own. I know that Tim is other than me. Before I even know Tim, in primo cadidens, first thing that I see is that a thing is not me. So for Aristotle, this being is self-evident lends itself to an understanding of the otherness of things. And since things are other, look what happens. The otherness of things leads to wonder. For Savannah talking about that, the importance of listening to Savannah. Why is she so full of wanting to listen? Because she wants to receive. And then she talked to you fellows about this poet, right? That we just receive the trees, receive everything around me. You read the poem. That's what he's talking about. The otherness of things intrigues the mind. And as we said the other day, wonder leads to questions. We can never repeat it too many times. Question leads to investigation. The investigation leads to discovery, analysis, which leads you to belief. And it's all based on this simple idea that things are not my mind. Difficulty is that that point is contested, and actually, in the minds of 95% of the philosophers in the world today has been shown to be utterly false. And it's the foundation upon which Aristotle stands. Now, you happen to be speaking to an intellectual son of Aristotle who really believes that Athens touched something that no other civilization has ever achieved intellectually. And that the finest example of Athens is this man right here. A huge proponent of realism. And who become Thomas Aquinas is a realist. And therefore, every like Catholic guy since has been a realist. To be fair, Augustine is not a realist. He was realist in the sense of he was a being, of course. But Augustine loved Plato. That's because Augustine was doing theology. And for theology, Thomas Aquinas was also doing theology, and he used Aristotle and Augustine and the traditions, and he was able to go further. That's being a moot point. The thing I want you to remember is that for a realistic perspective, being is not questioned. It's the foundation. That means the otherness. So for Aristotle, what he ends up doing is being is self-evident, the otherness, I'll put a different color here for you, it means that experience is the source of knowledge. Plato actually held just the inverse. For Plato, you're born with innate knowledge. You forget it during the trauma of birth, and you spend the rest of your life remembering things. So his understanding of knowledge is that, like, oh yeah, I knew that. How do you play the piano? And you're like uncovering your trauma to go back to what you already knew. And he had good reasons for saying that. It was a theory. Aristotle says, you have a tabula rasa. Beautiful Latin expression.
I know the tabula rasa.
Means a clean slate. Tabula rasa. Baby's born and just absorbs. Absorbs everything. And that you are still absorbing everything. And that the more that you live in wonder about that absorption, the more you live in silence. And the more profound of you live, you say you become. Because you realize you're trading the sacred ground of otherness. That experience is the source of everything, leads to a few conclusions. For example, that knowledge, truth comes from conforming my mind to what is real. Reality dictates truth. I could, in a realistic perspective, a boy is a boy, is a boy, is a boy. No, I really want to be a girl. There's a challenge. You're not. In an idealistic perspective, so Plato's school is called idealism, there's room. In an idealistic perspective, knowledge comes from me knowing an ideal that exists in another world. Reality deceives. You think that you love Catherine. Actually, what you're doing is loving woman. Catherine is just one of them. What you're really in love with is the ideal. So, says Plato, don't even worry about relationships then. Think of that, what it must be like to have a wife, and love that idea. For Aristotle, reality is the source of truth. For Plato, reality is the product of the mind. Truth is the product of the mind. Truth is the product of reality, truth is the product of the mind. And idealism has won. Intellectually, what happened, if you may have to go through the history of philosophy with you, but the whole history of philosophy in the West, the dominated by these two camps. And this camp has won. It's just hands down. Meeting a realist, it's like, it just doesn't happen. I mean, it happens, but it's like, especially happens in Catholic circles, thanks to Thomas Aquinas. But when you're out there talking to people, and you're like, I mean, it's reality. Why is it the Catholic Church against homosexual actions? And you're like, because that's not what the parts are made for. And then they're like, well, how do you know? And you're like, in primo caridens. I mean, like, what's so hard to figure out about this? It's not what it's made for. And they would say, justify that. What they're trying to do is that you keep going back to experience, saying, well, in experience, I see a love between a man and a woman is superior. Justify that. Prove that. And you're like, I don't need to prove it. I mean, it's just obvious. No, it's not obvious to me. Therefore, your truth can be doubted. Therefore, it's not true. What is true? I think I have a gender theory. Isn't that amazing? That's an example of that. Why do we walk around like, are we going to seriously base a civilization on a theory? I mean, like, well, yeah, because that's about as good as we can get as a theory. I mean, everyone has a theory. This one seems like a good one. That's idealism. So, when you're studying Aristotle, you're studying a man, therefore, who was focused on the sensations are at the source of wisdom. He loves the sensations. There's a famous picture by Raphael called The School of Athens, where it has, he puts in all the different philosophers. And they're
in Rome.
You did?
Yeah,
it's
in the Vatican Museum.
I think I got to go. I left early. Okay. Well, in that picture, do you remember who's in the center of the picture? You've all seen it before. In the center, there's two figures walking side by side. One, Plato, the other, Aristotle. And it's very famous because Plato has a book in his hand pointing up. Aristotle is looking at Plato to convince him, and his hands are out, or his hand is out like this, coming at you, and it's pointing down. Plato's truth is found up, Aristotle's truth is found down. It's really indicative of beautiful symbolism. For Aristotle, the sensations are the beginning and the source of knowledge. So, I could go into the whole thing, but I'd rather now move and give you how that plays itself out with Dan. In book one, you have an opening part, which is called the dialectics. Very useful. You will find in my teaching, I haven't really started to teach it yet, but when I start, you'll see I almost do this every single class. I'll find an opposite opinion, and then I'll find another opinion that contradicts that opposite opinion. Dialectics. They say, the famous, some say. And what Aristotle starts with is the opinions of the others. Very cool. He listens to everyone around him, and he's like, some say that soul is like this. Others say that soul is like this. Others say this, or it was like this, and you're like trying to follow him, and you're like, I don't even get it, you know? And then he's like, but if they say this, then they've contradicted this. And this doesn't seem to be correct at all. On the other hand, this person says that this person said that this person wasn't right. I tend to agree with him there. And he's just like making all these comments and giving you kind of like opinions. And then usually what he does, at the end of the dialectic, he ends up showing that none of them settle the question. He does this in almost every one of his books. It's so cool. And he's like, and yet, it seems that a clearer account of the thing is necessary. And then he pushes on, and he has this famous chapter 2, which is, no, it's book 2, sorry. So in book 2, chapter 1, he says, let us start afresh then. So you can almost skip book one if you really wanted to. It'll just confuse you. And in book two, chapter one and chapter two, what he does is he does this famous induction of the soul. And it is a jewel. You just have to go there. So you're going to have two classes on it with Father Francis Therese. Induction of the soul, where Aristotle proves that the soul exists. One of the, it's two of the most important pages on a piece, on a book that could possibly be. And yet, it's been completely destroyed intellectually by folks who have attacked it. You cannot have to listen to those critiques. Because I could counter them all and destroy them. But they all go to back to this. Experience is the source of knowledge. You're like, you can't trust your experience. What happened in the history of philosophy is that for all kinds of reasons, like you'll go into it if you wanted to, but I don't want to bury you in this. The trust, the confidence that we have in our minds is called the question. The thing is, how can I be sure? How can I be sure? How do you know that you're not the answer by the moderns is, you're right. There's just no way. And all of them, it's because they say, you can't trust your sensations. Aristotle says, you have to trust your sensations or you're mad. And then you have a David Hume who actually says, you can't trust your sensations. And if you live according to that truth, you would be crazy. So you have to act like you can. Even though you really can't. Yeah, because is it carrots at the store? I don't know if it's carrots or if it's celery or if it's a whale. Wow, he's like, yeah, actually, this could become a whale right in front of you right now. You have no idea what this is. You do not know. You cannot know if it'll be there forever. You don't know if it's going to change. You don't know anything about this thing. But he's like, but if you didn't, you'd never eat carrots. So you have to practically act like, I mean, you're just like, are you serious? And this is a guy that we're supposed to like respect. But he is serious, and he has found the mind of the mind. David Hume, Spock, Kant, Kant, Spock, Feuerbach, Feuerbach. And if you go through the whole history in Ecclesia, that's what I do with you guys, to explain it. It all comes back to this. For Hume, for Aristotle, so when you read this, pay a lot of attention. Because from that induction of the soul, Aristotle is able to talk about degrees of soul. So induction of the soul, this is basically the proof of soul. You know, Thomas Aquinas, he's like, I'll tell you how you can know there's a soul. The proof of the soul is so simple. It's the ability that we have to form a sentence. But like, for Aquinas, it's like, that's it. Proof of the soul, the ability to form a sentence. Because in a sentence, you're using abstract thinking and abstraction is the proof of the soul. Because it doesn't exist in reality. It's a concept that your mind has formed, drawing from the many experiences and holding something that's spiritual that it's found in the and we'll try to dispute all that, but in the end, I digress. The degrees of soul. Very important discussion. This is the understanding. He breaks it down into three types. The vegetative, the sensitive, and the intellectual. He spends the rest of the book, too, talking about the vegetative and the sensitive. So then he starts going into all the different sensations, and he talks about all the different things, the organs that we have, and color, and taste, and touch, and how it all works. And it all gets very confusing. The part you want to remember is book two, chapter one. Book three starts with this. And he talks about the intelligence and the will. The spiritual soul. Very, very important. And that's where we're going to spend a lot of time, life being like life of the world, because I want you to do that. He doesn't talk much about the body at all. That's I throw those courses in there because you need to understand that link. And you'll understand that link in Induction of the Soul, because you induce it as the source of the unity of God. But in any case, this book three is all about the acts of the intellect. What you're getting in Aristotle are answers, but you're going to have a hard time when you're reading them.
because of his writing style.
It's just extremely dense. Some people say that they make the theory that his books are actually notes in his lectures, because they kind of read like notes. They don't read like a book. It kind of sounds like someone's just kind of like skipping things. Don't be so easily fooled. But I doubt any of you are actually going to. There might be one or two that plunges into Aristotle. I highly recommend it. But what you want to get out of this is that where we're going in this class is you're going to start basically here in the book. We're going to talk briefly about this, and we're going to go down. Because what I want you to get out of this, I want you to know how to prove the existence of a spiritual soul and how to tell people that they're not from orangutans, and it's impossible, intellectually dishonest, to claim that you are an evolved orangutan. You can't. What you'll find is that it won't work. They won't believe. And it's because what you say is axiomatic. Mind, prove it. I don't need to. Obvious. I can show you things. It's like one of the signs Aristotle says. It says a human being is the one who smiles. It's called risibility. Proof of the human soul. National Geographic has a whole issue about animals smiling, and I know that. So they finished with this picture, I still remember, of a dolphin, all curved, looking at the camera with a smile. And you're like, that's not a smile. Animals can't smile. It's not a smile. But, well, how do you define smile? Oh, you're right. Oh, you're right. Just redefine everything. You don't know anything. Repeat after me. You don't know anything. I don't know anything. Repeat after me. You're confused. I'm confused. Now repeat after me. That's a smile. That's a smile. So simple. Isn't that terrible? That's exactly what we did. So, that's the overview of Aristotle. What I want you to get out of it, we got 10 more minutes. What I want you to get out of this is the understanding of realism. I'm going to actually open the floor so we can have a little discussion this time. Understanding of realism. Realism means that the other forms my knowledge of it. Being comes before my mind. This structure, therefore, begins an experience, specifically sensual experience, and ends in wisdom. Meaning knowledge of the other, the deepest knowledge of the other that I can have. Knowing the other in its relationship to God. It's pretty awesome. For Aristotle, this sensual experience of the soul, he starts with his experience of souled things, but soul things. And he asks the question, what makes them move? Especially, what makes them move themselves? That question, the key question. Which again, if you don't ask it, Aristotle, wait, rocks don't move, plants move. What's the difference? And why doesn't a plant walk? Some plants seem to walk. But this is another question. Why do plants walk? This is how we do this. And yet some animals seem to walk. And some walk on two legs. Some on four, some on three, some on one limb. And yet, if they walk, they seem to move themselves also by preference, like a horse that once having eaten oats never eats alfalfa again. This seems to be odd. themselves even against nature. Whereas a horse will always eat. Some men stop eating. Wherefore comes this power? Whence comes the strength? Question. That question leads him to discover there must be an explanation, or else reality doesn't make sense. Since reality makes sense, there must be an explanation. And it can't be found in the things themselves, in their difference. It has to be found in what all unites them. And what unites them is that even though there are many different things that one thing can do, it's always the one thing that is doing them. And never does he have to prove that. People will then be like, prove it's one thing, I think it's many things. And Aristotle will just be like, silence. You know, that's really... He said, if you doubt your senses, you are mad. He actually said, what to say to someone who says that one should not trust their senses? You should just walk away, for everything you tell them will be fine. So I regret that he did that, because I've come up with 5 justifications of realism. I'm just not going into it now. 5 ways that he fed realism, because I've had to. I'm in front of classes full of young idealists. How do you know? You know, you're just like, ah. So I've come up with 5 different defenses. He asks what makes the moon themselves, and then he does this journey called an induction. And that word you need to know, to induce. There's deduction, where you deduce. And then there's induction. Induction is certain knowledge, absolutely certain, without proof. So he'll, Father Francis, hopefully will go into this with you. But it's what makes it so tricky. But it's still true. And when you do an induction, you find the cause from the effect. Get that famous Latin, or famous logical phrase. If the streets are wet, it must have rained. The streets are wet. Induction. It could have been sprinklers. Could have been a fire hose. And it just leaves you going like, it wasn't a fire hose. How do you know it wasn't a fire hose? I don't. I mean, it could have been a fire hose, but it wasn't a fire hose. It was rain. I don't know. And because you proved the existence of the soul by an inductive form of reasoning, people will question you. Your whole life. What you have to remember is the fact that people question things doesn't make it less certain. It's not certain to them, probably because they lack the power of intellect that you possess. It's not every sandwich makes it upstream. That's the philosophy. And you have to kind of be like that because they're about to undo civilization based upon their lack of knowledge. The fact that you question it doesn't mean that I don't know it. I do know it. And you don't. Show you how I know it. There's no way that I could grow up and down and sideways and move my arm and still be me if there wasn't something inside of me that you meant me. Every 7 years, every cell in my body changes, but I'm still me. So you get idiots. I'm speaking philosophically. Right? People, you're not you. That's the whole thing. You're like, you're right. Where am I? You only exist in the moment. You know, they have all these things that you just have to look at and say to yourself, if I thought that way, I would be crazy. I would have no friends. I would have no purpose in my life. Why would I adopt that worldview? Because you're right. I can't prove that I'm still me. But I can know that I'm me. That I can prove it. Okay? You guys get where I'm going? So he induces the cause and the effect, and based upon the induction of the soul, he ends up with knowledge of the soul, which he writes out. Let's talk. What is that spirit? What questions? You guys understand? I just gave you a lot of just background stuff. If you've heard it before, you're utterly bored. If you've never heard it before, it's important that you know. Because this is what how philosophy.
So is there any form of philosophy, like, I mean, Aristotle, or like,
modern guys who do that, like they call themselves the Neotomists. Jock Maritain, Etienne Gilson, and others like that. Who in the 40s, 30s, 40s, 50s came out and kind of like tried to defend it. C.S. Lewis would be like someone that's kind of like that. You know, like in the comments about who perceived things. But most of them focused in on theology and kind of made their defense. Defense of Catholicism in a Catholic world. And this is nothing to do with theology. This is the tool that enables you to do theology. Because if you have this tool, look what your theology looks like. It has a whole different feel to it. But if your tool is think of a theory, it's probably right, and then defend it. So if that's the way most of us say, let's do philosophy, you're like, oh, now I'm good. I have an idea. The whole world is made of water. And then it'd be up to us. It's like, no, it can't be. Yes, it is. Look. And you're defending a theory. That's how philosophy is done. And that's why nobody cares about it. That's why we're also disgusted. It's like doing politics. And it's like, it's to no avail. Why should I sit around and think? And you're like, think about what you just said. Why should I think? Because by thought, you can know things. It's a whole different perspective. That's realism. Not just making up stuff, contemplating what is human, what is love, what is justice. I told you about Aristotle's two books, right? Nothing but questions. There's a book, Nothing But Questions. It's so cool. It doesn't answer a single one. And then his mind was just full of questions. I'd rather have that mind than yourself. But what can you do in the front of it? You cannot be bullied. If you can't take them, you can take them down, actually, if you really get into it. But what you really have to do is just be like, there's another worldview. If you tell me that there is no truth that's bigger than my mind, that means there's no truth bigger than your mind. That, my friend, is the doorway to tyranny. Because then I can't say that Hitler was wrong. And I can't say that D-Day is worth fighting for. But if we didn't say D-Day was worth fighting for, and Hitler was wrong, we would all be in deep doo-doo right now. And then people, are you going to seriously say that Hitler was wrong? No one would say that.
Yeah.
I've
been thinking about it. I I need to learn, I want to, that's one of the things I'm excited about being here for, is actually to be better able to make a defense for what is true. But then, it's like, then, you know, because there's so many students that I've spoken with who, you know, in my own little remedial way, like, we're able to make some progress. But you hit a wall, a lot of times it's an emotional wall. And so that's a really neat opportunity because great place to just, you know, if somebody's got something emotional that's blocking their intellect from being willing to, like, actually follow the truth for a lead, then you want to have a heart-to-heart conversation. And that can be really helpful. But I think, like, what's going through my mind is, like, the next thing for me, I mean, first, like, I gotta learn the intellectual, but then it's, like, what's next? It's, like, how to cast the vision then for our culture, so that they can see what we see, like how much better. It's not just, no, you're wrong and this is why, but rather what's so beautiful, like where does this lead, like the beauty that this leads to, you know what I mean, like living in reality, like that's, because right now it's like, what reason do they have to switch, to like, you know, be willing to make the mental effort to actually change their worldview? First, there's a lot of brokenness that blocks it, but then even then, when they know they're cared for and loved, it's like, what's the vision that we're casting as a Catholic culture to invite people in to even reconsider, you know,
that's beautiful.
That's
I'd love
what I'm here to learn.
I'd love to do that with you.
in a sense, it's not their fault. I mean, they really have simply soaked up the culture, and they haven't had something better for them to like, how do we reach them? And it's not only by saying, well, you're wrong, it's like, how, what are we trying to do?
I'd love to know what this is. Would you bring this up? All right, you guys. Well, your eyes are all being like mine. What a day. Let's take a break now.